So today we're going to be talking about the mean value theorem. Now you hear the word mean and you're like, that's my calculus teacher. They sure are mean. But no, it's not that kind of mean, because first off, there are no mean calculus teachers. We love all our students. But second off, the word mean here has a different meaning. So here we're referring to sort of an average. So when we hear the mean value theorem, we're talking about there's some sort of average involved. So we'll start out on a bit of a roll. In particular, we're going to be starting with what's called Rolle's theorem. Now, what does that say? Well, it says the following. Suppose you have a function, and it's on a closed interval from A to B, and there's a couple of basic assumptions. The endpoints are the same for the value of the function. The function is continuous, so usually we think continuous equals nice. All right, that's good. And the function is differentiable between the endpoints. All right. So if all of these things are true, then there is at least one C where I'm between my two ends where the derivative equals zero. All right. So what's the picture? So the picture here, we can sort of do a quick sketch. So I have my point A and my point B. And what we're told is that the value at A, in other words, the value of the function at A, is the same as the value of the function at B. So they both go at the same height. And now, the other thing that we know is that, lo and behold, if we sketch the function, and we have to sketch it in a couple ways. It has to be continuous. So if you think of continuity as, you know, we can't lift our pen. And it has to be differentiable. Now, here our notion of differentiable means that it's a smooth curve. In other words, there's something like the absolute value where you have that, you know, coming together at the very bottom there. Everything's smooth. So locally, you look flat. So we have some curve going in between, and it can do all sorts of erratic things, but it must follow the two rules, continuous and differentiable. All right, so if we satisfy all of that, then the story is somewhere in between, there is a place where the derivative equals zero. So for instance, if we look here, so what's the derivative? Well, think of the derivative as being a slope of a tangent line. What does the derivative equals zero mean? It means I have a flat tangent line. So for instance, if I see like a peak, that would be a place where the derivative equals zero. Or, you know, it doesn't have to be at the top, it could be here at the bottom. You know, it says there's at least one. Could be many. Now you might wonder, well, why do we need all of these conditions? Well, each one of them is important because you can imagine all sorts of things happening. So why do we need each one? Well, if we don't assume f of a equals f of b, what can you do? Well, you can just imagine you have a line that connects. And that line would never have a derivative of zero anywhere because the slope is always positive. Okay, well, why do you need to be continuous? All right, well, we could do something like the following. We could take the picture there in the previous one and just do this. So notice this is a function where f of a equals f of b, and it's differentiable between the endpoints, but it's not continuous, and we can see, well, there's no place where the derivative equals zero. All right, well, what about the last thing, differentiable? All right, well, that one's pretty easy to convince ourselves of, because you could do something, say, like the following, where you could have it go as like an upside-down absolute value function. Well, see, that peak, the derivative doesn't equal zero there, it's undefined. The derivative is never zero. So these are examples showing we cannot lose any one of these three assumptions. We need them all. All right, so why is Rolle's theorem true? It's nice to sort of try to get the idea of, okay, why do these things happen? Well, we're going to build off of a really important idea that we talked about in our previous session, which is the extreme value theorem. Okay, what does that mean? Well, because our function is continuous on a closed interval, that's our second bullet point here, then it has to be the case that there is an absolute max and an absolute min. All right, good. Now, let's think about it. Well, what if our absolute max and absolute min happened at our endpoints? Okay, so they happened at A and B simultaneously. Well, what do we know about the function at A and the function at B? We know that the function at A is equal to the function at B. All right? So that says if our absolute max and absolute min happen at our endpoints, then the function in between has to be flat because I can't go up or down because that would be larger or smaller than my endpoints. And a flat function in between means my derivative is zero everywhere. Okay, good. That case is done. So now we say, all right, so the absolute max occurs somewhere other than our endpoints, or it could be the absolute min, but one of them. Let's say absolute max. Absolute max occurs somewhere other than an endpoint. Now, what has to be true? We know that an absolute max has to be a critical point. In other words, what I mean is it has to occur where there is a critical point. Now, what kind of critical points do we have? Well, we have endpoints. Well, we said it's not an endpoint, so it's not that. Okay, we have the derivative is undefined, but look, our assumption here, f is differentiable, says it has to be defined. So it's not that. So that only leaves us with our third option, which is that our derivative equals zero, which is what we want to show. And now we're done. So that's Rolle's theorem. All right, so there we go. Now, that's our warm-up. The next one is the main event, the mean value theorem. And it's very similar. We just sort of drop one assumption. The assumption we drop is what's happening at our endpoints. They don't always have to be the same. Now they can be different from each other. So here we go. We have a function on a nice interval, closed bounded interval, and we're continuous from A to B, including A and B, and we're differential between A and B. Then, and here's the idea. There is some point C, maybe more than one, but at least one, where the derivative at C is equal to f of B minus f of A over B minus A. Now, what do you notice? Well, the left-hand side, this is an instantaneous rate of change. So in other words, it's what's happening at C. Whereas the right-hand side, this is going to be the average rate of change. So this, by the way, you see the word average, that's where the word mean is coming from, because mean is a type of average. So the mean value theorem says, hey, lo and behold, there has to be some place where your change is average. All right, so that's the idea. There has to be some place where instantaneous rate of change equals our average rate of change. Good, good. So how do you prove it? Well, it turns out that the mean value theorem is basically the Rolle's theorem. It's just turned sort of slanted-like. In fact, you can see how Rolle's theorem follows, because if f of b were equal to f of a, you'd have some place where the derivative equals zero. That was our conclusion from Rolle's theorem. On the other hand, once you know Rolle's theorem is true, you can get to the mean value theorem by looking at the following function. Look at g of x, which is f of x minus f of b minus f of a over b minus a times x minus a. Now, let's just plug in some numbers and see what happens. Suppose we were to plug in x equals a. What would we get? Well, if you plug in x equals a, you have that a minus a, which means the last part disappears, you get f of a. What if you plugged in b? Well, if you plugged in b, you see there's a b minus a over b minus a. Those cancel. Then you have f of b subtract f of b, which cancels. The only thing that doesn't cancel is that minus minus f of a, and therefore that ends up being f of a. So what you get is, lo and behold, g of a is equal to g of b. And they're both equal to f of a. And now you say, well, wait. My function here, this is continuous. This is continuous because it's a line. So my new function g is continuous. This is differentiable by assumption. A The line is differentiable, so my new function is differentiable. And therefore, we can conclude by Rolle's theorem, there has to be some place where g prime of c equals 0. Well, let's think about the derivative. The derivative of f would be f prime. So that would be f prime of c. And here, it's the derivative of a line. The derivative of a line is the slope of the line, which is f of b minus f of a over b minus a. So this becomes f prime of c minus f of b minus f of a over b minus a equals 0. And now that's it. There's our mean value theorem. We're done. We proved it, at least assuming you believe Rolle's theorem, which we did that too. So yeah, we are done. Good. Now here's the picture to keep in mind. So what do we have here? So we have this function. So we can highlight our function. So here's our function going from someplace a f of a to b f of b. So we're going between our endpoints. And when we're looking at that f of b minus f of a over b minus a, that is our slope here. So this is our slope of the line that connects the two ends. All right, so let me get a line here and marker and indicate. So this has slope equals f of b minus f of a over b minus a. And now what the mean value theorem says is, hey, there's going to be at least one, possibly more, places where if I look at the tangent line, so here I'm drawing these tangent lines in, the tangent line to that is going to be parallel to my slope connecting the two ends. So in other words, this has a slope which is f prime of c. It's our derivative. And so we really have some sort of parallel notion. Well, how could we use mean value theorem? There is an application that not everybody appreciates, but it's a way to catch speeding. So you can imagine that you're driving in a remote area and a patrol vehicle can see you at two places which are a known distance apart, let's say 1 mile apart. And then what they can do is they wait till you pass the first point and they start their watch. And they wait till you get to the second point and they stop the watch. And now they look at how much time it took for you to get from the two points. All right, well, how can they use this information? Well, what they know is they know your average speed to get from point A to point B. So let's say it took you 1 minute. So if it took you 1 minute to go 1 mile, they know you were traveling at an average speed of 60 miles per hour. What's the conclusion they can make? Well, the conclusion they can make is if you were traveling at an average speed of 60, then at some point in time, you had to be traveling exactly 60. Not just an average of 60, exactly 60. And so if the speed limit was 55, they caught you. All right. Well, all right. An application. Now for us, we do have an application which will be coming on in the near future. So we're going to keep the following useful fact in mind. So it says the following. Suppose we know that the derivative is equal to 0 from a to b. Then the conclusion is the function has to be constant. All right. Well, you know, in some sense, we're like, hey, we knew beforehand, if our function is constant, our derivative is 0. See, this is now reversing the idea. And sometimes it seems like, oh, reversing is easy, right? No, you have to work on it sometime. So the question, why is this true? So if the derivative is 0, why must our function be a constant? Well, what we can think of is there's this sort of interesting idea in logic, and it's called the contrapositive. So this is a very fancy way, and you can sort of see the word contrary inside here. So it's sort of like, I'm, you know, to the contrary. Well, let's sort of flip things around is the idea. And there's this basic setup. So if some statement, we'll call it A, holds, then some other statement B holds, that's sort of one thing we're trying to conclude. Like, for example, if our derivative equals zero, then our function is constant. Well, it turns out that what you can do is to flip it around. This is equivalent to showing if it's not the case that B holds, then it's not the case that A holds. So what's an example of this? You could say, well, if it's raining, then it must be cloudy. Okay, that's a statement. If it's raining, so A is it's raining, then B, it's cloudy. So if we flip the two around, the contrapositive would say, if it's not cloudy, then it's not raining. All right, so that's the idea. So how do we use it here? Well, we want to show if the derivative is equal to zero, then the function is constant. Now we can do the sort of the opposite, which says, okay, if the function is not constant, right? Because that's the opposite of saying our function is a constant, comma, then f prime of x is not equal to zero for some point. All right, so that's sort of the flip. So if I want to show that this is true, I just have to argue, why is this true? Well, since the function is not constant, that means it's going to go up and down in some way. So it goes up and down, and therefore, you know, here's my A, here's B. At some place, it's going to be higher, and at some place, it's going to be lower. And now, by the mean value theorem, I can look at the rate of change between the two points where they differ, and I know they have to differ because it's not constant. That rate of change is going to be not zero. Mean value theorem says, then therefore there must be some place where the derivative matches that rate of change, and that means that the derivative is not zero. Okay, all right, so that's the idea. That's how we can get to that statement. Now, how do we use it? Well, here we go. We have the now interesting fact. If two derivatives are equal, then the functions they came from are only off by a constant. So what does that say? Well, if I'm looking for some function, I don't know what I'd call it, the opposite of derivative, the OP derivative, I don't know, we'll have to figure that out someday. But so if I'm somehow trying to find, hey, what's a function whose derivative is equal to something? Well, this says you might be off by a constant, but that's it. So you're only off by a constant. So that would be useful to know if we're ever looking for those OP derivatives or what, you know, whatever we're going to call such a thing. Who knows? Well, stay tuned. We'll get there. All right. Well, time for some practice. Good luck.